Olá, pessoal. Eu sou Fernanda Filgueira Sauerbrum, professora do programa de pós-graduação em Ciências Contábeis da UFRJ. Hoje é dia 18 de julho de 2023. Nós estamos aqui para a segunda palestra do ciclo de palestras do professor Jim Haslam, da Universidade de Durham, aqui na UFRJ, na visita dele ao Brasil pelo programa CAP-SPRINT, com apoio do governo federal. E nós, hoje, nessa palestra, o professor Jim vai falar sobre contabilidade emancipatória, né, sobre os aspectos teóricos e metodológicos e empíricos, né, da pesquisa em contabilidade emancipatória. O professor Jim Haslam, como apresentei ontem, ele tem uma longa carreira na área de contabilidade crítica, com muitos trabalhos, sendo uma importante referência na temática de contabilidade emancipatória. Professor Jim, presenting you very briefly. I know that you're going to introduce your work and all your trajectory in the topic. So feel free, we are here with our students and colleagues from our department and a huge group in the YouTube too. So be welcome to our second speech today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Fernanda. It's an honor to be here at the Federal University of Rio de Janeiro, and it's a university very fortunate to have this great lady, Fernanda Sauerbrun, sorry, got to pronounce your name correctly. This particular title, I was just saying beforehand that just about be acceptable in a journal article because it's 20 words. 20 words. It's one of my shorter titles, you know, for a presentation. Emancipatory accounting is a really big topic, very interdisciplinary. Accounting is one of the most interdisciplinary areas to study, really. And emancipatory accounting is certainly lives up to that. It would include a hermeneutics, for instance, because you're thinking about what the meaning of these words are and debating that. It would include psychoanalytical perspectives because of the importance of the conscious and the subconscious in relation to notions of emancipation. And of course, it would imply social and political theory as sort of obvious frames of reference. Critical. What about critical perspective? At this point, it might be quite nice to draw a little diagram. And I'll try to do it like this so that you can see me and the drawing of the diagram. And if you think about accounting, here is accounting, which I've not sort of given any specific character to, but let's use this generic notion of accounting. We can see it being influenced in all kinds of different ways from the context of which accounting is part. And we can see accounting having all kinds of influences on society. We can also see some sort of feedback so that, the influences is that it has shaped the feedback, maybe people like it or people don't like it and it starts to change and so on. Going to depict that as in a context. And then over here, we're going to see different accounting. This is a vision of a better accounting. This is a vision of a better accounting with perhaps better influences upon it. So a better accounting in a better context. And we can envisage this current situation accounting in the current context and a better accounting in a better context. And then in the middle, we can think about T, which could be transformation, possibly tension. So we can use the letter T in English for this. And this is all being envisaged in a context. There is our researcher or observer. But not her. Okay. Now this particular, like the cartoons in the films and so on, is envisaging current context, the better context and the transformation. They are located in a context, and the important principle that comes to mind there is the principle of reflexivity. Because they're in a context, the perspective is going to be influenced by that context. So when they see things as they are, when they see things how they, if you like, should be, or the notion of a better, which is a much more practical way of thinking about the should be, and the transformation and tension in between. They are going to see all those things and envisage possibilities for change in a context that's going to influence them. So this vision won't be a perfect one. And of course it will change over time. As the accounting changes, the notion of a better will change, and the notion of transformation and tension will change. This is the way of thinking about critical perspective that derives, I guess, from a Hegelian way of thinking. You know, everything is in there together. Everything is interacting with everything else. And because there's a problematic accounting, or because anything is problematic in this left-hand side, this vision on the left-hand side, then the whole thing is problematic because of the Hegelian axiom of relations, internal relations. And so that way of thinking stems from the, I suppose, the German critical theoretical tradition, which has been questioned in many ways in recent times. But I suppose by thinking about it in Hegelian terms, you see the difference between this critical notion and the general notion of critical. Because the general notion of critical is one that pretty much everyone can relate to. Because who is not critical? Who is not critical when it comes to anything in society? Is everyone happy? Or is anyone happy, I should say, with the world as it is? Very few people would sort of put their hand up and say, yes, I am happy with the world as it is, or even, I think some people think the world, is perfect, and so on. There's the famous story, isn't there, that informs Tony Tinker's work at one point. He wrote a paper called Apologizing in Style. Apologizing in Style. He had some very good titles in his papers. And he references French writer Voltaire and the character Candide in one of Voltaire's texts. And, you know, Candide is always saying, oh, this is the best of all possible worlds. So, yeah, it's a problem, but it's the best of all possible worlds. So that's another way of thinking about the world where perhaps you wouldn't see it as the world where everyone was happy, but you would see it as the best of all possible worlds. A bit like Winston Churchill says of democracy, it's really an awful system, but it's the best system we have. You know, these kind of conservative, really, ways of thinking. Okay, so that's a kind of introduction to a sort of critical way of thinking, and we're going to sort of maybe begin to deconstruct it later. Don't know if this works already. It does. Just to begin with a note on constructs and concepts, you can see in the title it says the theoretical development of a construct. The construct is emancipatory accounting. Why have I called it a construct rather than a concept? I'm not sure that matters that much, but I remember many years ago a professor giving a lecture trying to explain the difference between constructs and concepts. And the idea was that a construct involved two or more ideas coming together, and a concept, just one. So emancipatory accounting becomes a construct. Second thing, it's always dangerous to refer to the origins of a phenomenon. Someone will always say, ah, but I know that that was earlier. You know, it's particularly dangerous in his historical work. Oh, that was the first time that someone mentioned accounting, you know. Ah. I did upset Professor Anthony Hopwood many years ago by contradicting his view that certain things began on a certain date or after a certain date. Usually on the very next day I would say, ah, what about this? So for example, when he suggested that the word management wasn't used before a particular date, and I'm sorry, I can't remember what the date was, I then showed evidence showing that the word management was used, you know, about 100 years before, you know, in the English language. Another one, which probably really upset him actually, because he was associated with this. He used to use the word, and you've probably seen this in articles in accounting organizations and society, he used to use the word accountings, the plural of accounting. And he thought he had created this word. So it was a really sensitive issue, you know. And I said, have you seen Samuel Johnson's dictionary? Of course, this is about 200 years ago. And let's have a look at the word accounting. Oh, look, accountings. is in the, you know, so anyway, but it is dangerous to refer to the origins of a phenomenon. There's also that complicating factor of equivalent, overlapping, or similar ideas. So, for example, we might be able to identify that the very first time someone wrote the words emancipatory accounting was X, and here X would maybe be 1984. Because in 1984, Tony Tinker, in a book edited by himself, entitled The Social Accounting for Corporations, Social Accounting for Corporations in 1984, uses the expression emancipatory accounting. As far as I know, it's the first time anyone wrote that down in English. And I should also explain that this is coming from an English-speaking context, so there's a certain amount of ethnocentrism, Eurocentrism involved there as well, and issues of translation. I normally always refer to Jeremy Bentham in my lectures. I can't resist it. Yesterday, I think I did this, didn't I, when I was talking about the theory and method. And Jeremy Bentham, of course, hello. Jeremy Bentham, of course, was writing before the manifestation of a formally organized accountancy profession. Accountancy practice, accounting go back a long, long time. But people argue that the first time accountancy profession was formally organized was in Scotland around the 1850s. Now, again, that could be a Eurocentric, ethnocentric type perspective. Bentham, of course, died in 1832, but he wrote a lot about accounting, sometimes referring to it as bookkeeping, and sometimes referring to it as publicity or accounting publicity, making things visible to the public. Publicity today means something like advertising. But making things visible to the public is an idea that we've kind of lost sight of certainly in the UK context, possibly you still find it appreciated more, or the link is stronger in the Scandinavian countries and the German-speaking countries, where they have, for example, had laws called Publicitätsgesetz, publicity law. So they've hung on to that idea a bit more than we have. But people still use the word in a similar way to how it was used in Bentham's time and in the 18th century. In fact, the expression accounting publicity was used a lot in Bentham's time. It wasn't a particularly unusual expression or one associated with Bentham. And if we were trying to assess whether Bentham's ideas were original, we could do a similar job on Bentham as I did with Anthony Hopwood's views on management and the accountings. But you know, in terms of Bentham's ideas, I mean, Bentham had ideas like wanting to use accounting to make the powerful visible. Those who have the power should be visible to everyone else. This was a principle of Bentham, often forgotten because the inverse of that is usually emphasized by people who are critical of Bentham, as I think you may appreciate. Also, Bentham had the view that accounting should be inclusive. Everybody should be able to understand it. The language of bookkeepers is an expert language that is reflecting the interests of the bookkeepers. I am paraphrasing Bentham. Notions of counter-accounting can be found in Bentham with his early appreciation of unofficial publicity. He had the quite naive idea that a government should pay for an organization to be critical of government. In other words, here's some money, go away and criticize me. He also spoke of accounting for justice. He referred to publicity in general as the soul of justice. He thought accounting was a branch of ethics and more important in changing people's ethical behavior than in shaping the nature of the economy. He had a stakeholder perspective on accounting. For example, in his model prison, which of course has been heavily analyzed and criticized and seen as a metaphor for modern society and so on. But in his model prison, he wanted the prisoners to be able to write about their experiences of their time in prison when they left the prison. Of course, many of them couldn't write at the time that they were in the prison, but one of his policies was to make sure that the prisoners could write. And then when they left the prison, they could write about their experiences and that would be published to the world. So the point is that, you know, if you want some kind of equivalent, overlapping or similar ideas, you can think about Bentham as the kind of prototype modern accounting, critical accounting person. Habermas sees Bentham like that, interestingly enough. Jürgen Habermas sees Bentham as an early critical theorist, actually, which is a surprising insight in terms of many appreciations of Bentham. Not that I'm trying to apologize for Bentham here. I know you will get that impression. In fact, if you look at work I've done and with Sonia Gallhofer on Jeremy Bentham, there's a kind of very critical appreciation of Bentham's writing running through it. There are perhaps some good reasons for giving attention to the construct emancipatory accounting today, reasons for being attracted to it. First of all, if we think of the state of the world today, many people do feel that there are problems, significant problems, in fact, some of them quite imminent. And emancipatory accounting is suggestive of a radical and progressive practice that may attract the attention of many people today. I'm trying to explain as well why so many people seem to be using this construct emancipatory accounting today, because that has really mushroomed, that has really taken off. Good for my citations. Good for the citations of the papers that I've been involved in, which is great. Secondly, the philosophical developments of relatively recent times are often interpreted in downbeat terms. Some philosophers are interpreted as pessimists. Used to be the case that people said Schopenhauer was the only real pessimistic philosopher who believed that everything was going to come to an end. Well, there are some scientists who think like that as well. Notions of limited hopefulness, the loss of a principle of hope, the lack of a vision of social betterment, So you get a lot of critical theorists writing in the 80s talking about this idea of we need to hang on to a vision. We need to have a vision. Usually in relation to the Foucault-Habermas debate. Notions of problematic regimes being transformed, but only to result in other problematic regimes without an apparent language of assessment. You know, I mean, one regime might be problematic and it might be replaced by a problematic regime, but how do you assess them? Which is the better one? Emancipatory accounting kind of suggests a counterpoint to such downbeat thinking. So it might be attractive to people. And thirdly, beyond the idea that accounting is a negative force, because if you analyze much of the critical literature on accounting, what does it stress? It stresses accounting as a negative force. Accounting is destructive, you know, it destroys things. It distributes wealth on behalf of the wealthy and the powerful. It actually results in pollution and doesn't really do much for our environment. Accounting tends to focus our attention on things that are very narrow. It changes the way we think. It makes us think of children and adults in the same way as debit and credit and profit and loss. It makes us think of disabled and able-bodied people in the same way as debit and credit. And assets and liability. So it's very dangerous, and it's very negative. Now, you know, we can get insights into that, we can agree with that, but at the same time, emancipatory accounting is trying to go beyond that. It's from a critical perspective, from a critical tradition, it's saying, no, there's an emancipatory accounting here, you know. I mean, from that kind of very critical negative view of accounting, it's like emancipatory accounting is a contradiction. You know, it's like a contradiction in terms. You're putting together this term accounting, which is like negative, and you put in this term emancipatory together with it. It's a contradiction from that point of view. So again, it's attractive because people can think beyond that way of thinking. Having arrived at this critical position, invited to step back and think, hang on, maybe there's something positive about this. The word is control, because actually in some countries and in some languages, the word control is often used where we would use accounting in English. So, for example, in German, the word controller has a kind of resonance as accounting. And the word control is often associated with negatives. But, you know, think of the control that's involved in bringing up a child. I think I did mention, didn't I, that child and adult might be seen in the same terms as debit and credit and profit and loss. And so on. But think of the way we think about bringing up a child. It involves control. It's not negative, is it? What would it mean to say, oh, we're not interested in, in looking after this child. We're not interested in providing for this child. What about self-control? Is that negative? You know? Anyway, accounting is something that can be rescued in this respect. By the way, just a little story before I forget it, and I'm going to get to mention it later. Of conventional external accounts these days, from a critical perspective, as not especially radical phenomena, you know, not especially progressive phenomena. If anything, from a critical perspective, they are seen as like part of the negative apparatus that's kind of serving the powerful and distorting people's thinking and so on. But if you go back to a parliamentary committee of the 1830s in Britain, which was a committee to discuss a banking crisis, because yes, there were banking crises in the 1830s, and they gathered together around this committee people who had a view on the crisis and how to prevent it in the future. So there were lawyers, there were merchants. No one was actually called an accountant. Talking about the 1830s, so maybe we wouldn't actually refer to the accountant, but I'll make a point about that in a moment. But accounting was discussed, and accounting publicity was discussed by the people around the committee. So some people said, oh, one solution to this crisis is to make the banks produce their accounts to the world, you know, make them disclose their accounts to the world. Now, this was interesting in terms of how it was interpreted by the people who were chairing the session, because they said, wow, you can't do that. What will people want next? They actually use these words. What will people want next if we require the banks to publish this accounting information? This is far too radical. We are going to be encouraging a revolution like in France. They did use these words. Of course, the French Revolution hung on the establishment of Britain in the early part of the 19th century and the late 18th century. This is one of the things they feared. And they were at war, of course, with France until 1815. That particular context was a context in which it was very dangerous to write radical and critical things, very dangerous. And coming back to Jeremy Bentham again, he was very careful what he said and what he published during that period. You know, it was different for Karl Marx and Lenin. You know, when Marx and Lenin came to Britain and they worked in the British Library because they were escaping oppression in continental Europe or in Russia, these writers could write what they wanted, because there was a tradition of liberalism in Britain, but not in the early 19th century. You can read poems by the famous poet Shelley, The Mask of Anarchy, in which he is being very critical of the British statesmen who were dictators. Of course, Shelley spent a lot of time in Italy, not in Britain, where he would have probably been arrested, but he was a poet, and so you could get away with a lot as a poet. And I was mentioning to Fernanda earlier this morning that Bentham respected many of the things that poets wrote, visited many of the people who had been put in prison during that time to sympathize with the situation. And he himself was very careful about what he wrote in public. But another interesting thing about Bentham, again, I can't resist talking about Bentham. In one of his letters, he signed it, Jeremy Bentham, the accountant. Jeremy Bentham, the accountant. okay. The expression itself, emancipatory accounting, seems to have been first used as such by Tinker in 1984 in an edited book on social accounting for corporations, and in 1985, Paper Profits, not the spelling though, a social critique of accounting. The precise complexity of this, precise meaning of emancipatory accounting for Tinker, including the differences between the two usages, between 1984 and 1985, because they are slightly different, is not especially important here. What is important for the purposes of this presentation is the substantive meaning of emancipatory accounting. It's through a Marxist lens, using a Marxist writer, Ullman, and it is the accounting that transforms or helps to transform the world through a revolution to the better state. And we can maybe put that in long terms. So we're actually seeing accounting helping to transform the world to the new world born, to the best state, if you like. And that is his understanding of emancipatory accounting. Now, Tinker, 1985, articulates the content of this accounting. And of course, that's very interesting to look at. It's an accounting that illuminates, my apologies, the exploitation. Obviously, I meant to say though, not the exploration. The exploitation of labor by capital, translated to the level of the capitalist firm. And in simple terms, what Tinker is suggesting is that the accounts of companies should indicate how much of the wealth is being distributed to labor, and to show that it's a very small proportion of the wealth. In the New World Born, a particular enabling accounting will emerge to serve the better state. So this, if you like, is the ultimate notion of enabling accounting. It's the enabling accounting that serves the better state. Enabling accounting is also an expression used in accounting where it kind of has a fairly neutral meaning. It's accounting that enables anything. So whatever you want enabling, it enables it. So it could be a positive or a negative or a repressive or emancipatory force. But this enabling accounting is the enabling accounting that emerges after this revolutionary situation. Tinker did not coin that term. And there's a lot of my kind of, I suppose, interpretation here. Means because he's not arguing in the new world there is no accounting. This is my point. So what is he arguing about accounting? Something like enabling in that sense. Yeah. Very abstract ideas. Very problematic in detail, of course.
It's interesting, the idea of enabling.
Yeah, oh, by the way, you can ask questions at any stage.
It's interesting, the idea of enabling accounting. Yeah. Maybe instead of using emancipatory accounting, because emancipatory accounting, we goes back to this Marxist Frankfurtian way of thinking and criticizing it and thinking the way things must change.
That's right.
It's through right. Emancipation,
yeah, you're right.
Non-alienation.
Right.
Yes.
There's a big overlap, isn't there?
Yes, yes.
The usage of enabling accounting and the usage of emancipatory accounting.
And maybe enabling accounting can accommodate several perspectives
exactly.
of emancipation.
Yeah, well, yes, it can. My point is that in principle, you could enable something regressive. You could enable something negative. One of the main uses of enabling accounting and enabling control in the literature is to refer to an accounting that basically helps the company to run well, you know, as opposed to being counterproductive. And, you know, so it's about, in that sense, it's about an accounting that generates more profits, for instance. You know, it's an enabling accounting in that sense. Yeah, you probably see. So in that yeah, okay, Tan.
No, I just agree with Fernanda, because when I think emancipatory accounting, you think emancipatory for whom?
Yeah.
So this is hard to think, because when I discuss with this amazing diagram, that like for me, I was thinking, yeah, in the 70s, you have this qualitative perspective in accounting, in qualitative, talking about methods.
Yes.
The current accounting just changed for a better accounting. Mm. After that, then change, and now we discuss counter accounting, shadow accounting.
Yes.
So it's good to think this current is have to change to a better, and better become current account. Yes. And now have to, so yeah, it's good to think emancipatory or enabling accounting.
Yeah, well, in terms of Fernanda's point, I think one of the best illustrations of what Fernanda was suggesting, in other words, that often there's an overlap between the terms, would be to look at that special issue of accounting, auditing and accountability journal, which I think was published in 1986, I could be wrong though. It was edited by Broadbent, Jane Broadbent, myself, Sonia Galhofer and Penny Cianconelli. And certainly in that particular issue, there's lots of papers that use enabling accounting in a similar way to emancipatory accounting, I would say. Yeah. So that would definitely illustrate your point there. Mm-hmm. Okay, any more questions?
Marcelo has one.
Marcelo, yes.
I don't know if you answer now or after, but looking to this figure, I want to know how do you suggest the transformation from current to critical perspectives occur in the field and or by the subjects in the field?
Yes.
How do you suggest this transformation?
Okay, well, the transformation, and I think if I understand you correctly, you're sort of bringing out complexity of this. The transformation is the practice, but it's also a transformation of the concept in a way that might help in the transformation of the practice, we can think here about whether there are processes at work which are changing things, you know, without any kind of very strong agency. We can think about that. Or we can think about agency being involved to change these accountings. And actually, I'm glad you asked the question, because I've remembered that accounting as practice here and as concept appears at least three times on this diagram. Does anybody know the third place? You can see it here, yeah?
Yeah?
And you can see it here. What's the third place? Any suggestions? Here. Because, and this takes us back to views of emancipatory accounting, because accounting itself can be something that's mobilized to change things. Yeah? So you've got the accounting here, but accounting itself in some form, like some content, could be involved in the changing of things. And in fact, that's emancipatory accounting in a way.
You can say that resistance
accounting. Yeah, accounting that resists. Yeah, accounting that resists, exactly, which could be integral to a more emancipatory accounting. That's right. So accounting takes place, manifests three times in the diagram. But you're right, you know, you need to think about it as a practice, you need to think about it as a concept. How to achieve it, you know, the big question of praxis, if you like, This is clearly not an easy thing, of course. This is a very this is why I said at the beginning, you know, it involves so many things. It's so difficult an idea, social theory, the appreciation of the social and the psychoanalytic dimension, and thinking about the hermeneutics of what accounting might mean. You know, I mean, so the dimensions are really complex, and but it's somehow important, I think, to try to intervene and do something because of the state of the world. You know, if we think about the state of the world today, especially in relation to the environmental and ecological crisis, we have a sense of things being urgent. We have a sense of being urgent. I've often thought that more conservative perspectives are grounded or shaped by a sense of lack of urgency, you know, unless the only urgency is about preventing progressive change. You know, the conservative perspectives, and you find them in academia, and you find them in approaches to accounting that are informed by social theory, for instance. And I often find that that conservatism seems to rest in part on a sense that there's no urgency for change. We don't need to change. So we can be cautious about change, very cautious about change. We can appreciate the negatives and concentrate on the negatives that can happen if we change. You know, we change things, but we go backwards, you know, that kind of notion, which is a bit like Candide saying, this is the best of all possible worlds, even if it's a problematic one. So to me, we need to reinvest in the idea that we do need to intervene to change, albeit with all the kind of, I mean, Bertrand Russell, the philosopher, wrote that one of the challenges we have as people is to act without really knowing. This is difficult. This is a difficult thing. He was a person trying to be very progressive, but he appreciated that we act without really knowing. For some people, that's a big problem, and it influences their conservatism. But it depends, in a sense, about how much you sense or understand the world to be in a problematic context. Okay, we may return to those questions, Marcel, but I'm glad you asked that question. Tinker subsequently drew from the early Frankfurt School in neo-Marxist theory to refine his position, not really referring anymore to the expression emancipatory accounting. So he would draw from Adorno, Horkheimer, Gramsci, for instance. And Tinker was a very inspiring academic. And if you read his early papers, they're very inspirational. He was a very inspirational figure, as was Cheryl Lehman, who worked closely with him, and Marilyn Niemark. Sorry about the writing here. Theoretical developments in the social sciences and humanities, namely post-structuralism, post-modernism, and post-Marxism, have problematized the idea of emancipation. There's a very interesting special issue of a journal called Development and Change, published in 1992. And there's lots of interesting papers in that journal that deal with the issue of emancipation and what emancipation means today. And they were thinking about emancipation, these theoretical movements of post-structuralism, post-modernism, and post-Marxism. It's a really interesting special issue. And some of the insights are actually summarized in the book Galofer and Haslam, 2003. If you haven't got it in the library, order it. No, actually, you know, we don't get any royalties. We've never claimed any royalties, and I think it's partly because they've forgotten our address, and it's also partly because at the end when we were writing the book, I remember I was very ill at one point, and we were doing the index, and they offered to pay for someone to do the index, and I said, let's pay it. And that put us into massive debt in the book. And I don't think we've quite recuperated that debt. So no royalties for us on this book. But if you look at Galifrey and Aslan 2003, chapter one, there is an appreciation of these perspectives on emancipation and trying to rescue the idea and what emancipation means today. In Laclau's book, Emancipation, so he has an S in brackets. In Laclau's book, Emancipation, it's quite intriguing because he argues in that book that perhaps we should use another word to emancipation, because emancipation has so many problematic associations with communist Marxist revolution. And of course, Laclau himself was a Marxist writer, very strongly influenced by Gramsci, in fact. So more of a neo-Marxist writer, I guess. And so was Chantal Mouffe. And, you know, they thought that the word emancipation might be a problem to use, which is kind of strange because the book is called Emancipation. And he uses emancipation so much in the book. But as I say, there is this concern to rescue the term and maybe give it a different meaning. And I think there is a problem if you're trying to change words because you think of the negative associations. It's very easy to put a negative association on another word that you use instead of it. I mean, I think they preferred the word liberation, but, you know, in so many contexts that might have negative associations as well. So attempts to see what can be rescued for emancipation flourished and flourish. Laclau made the point that a pristine transformation to an absolutely better world through revolution has no theoretical validity. If you look back at this diagram, if you're in this context and there are problems in this context, how can you go from a context with a problem to a context where there are no problems? How can you do that? The theoretical validity seems missing. Actually, in Hegelian terms, you would have a big problem with that argument, right? Because Hegelian philosophy divides into the more radical perspectives and the more conservative perspectives. You know, Hegel himself, people are not really clear about it, but they think that Hegel was much more of a conservative thinker, you know. So he would have stressed the sense in which these notions like revolution, they're not going to work, because how can you go from a problem-ridden world to one without problems just through revolution? Well, I mean, experience might suggest that as well, but the point is that Laclau basically agrees with that position. But they're also seeking to rescue the notion of emancipation, even if they're saying we shouldn't use the word. I don't precisely know what's going on there, whether they're trying to provoke debate. Maybe that's what they're trying to do. We are left with a strategy that's much more uncertain. And I'm reminded of Alan's question yesterday, if you remember that question about the postmodern context to thinking about how to do research. Much more uncertain. Where a cautious and pragmatic approach applies. Emancipation here approaches an intersubjective notion of betterment. It's really what it starts to look like. In other words, emancipation is a better situation, a better world, a better situation even, something more micro level as well as macro level. something better, something that can lead to some kind of betterment. This is quite different from the notion of revolution to change to a better place. Also, it embraces the notion of a plurality of emancipatory projects. So this, again, is confusing because pluralism in political theory has many meanings. The meaning here is this idea that there are many projects, emancipatory identities, and emancipatory interests. A plurality of projects, identities, and interests is articulated, and hence emancipations. The notion of chains of equivalence is articulated by Laclau and Muth. The notion of different interests, different identities, different projects, somehow trying to make an alliance between themselves, even if they are different, in order to bring about some progressive change in the society. Some of these allies might be very unusual. People have theorized, for instance, how very unusual allies can get together to try to stop the expansion of airports. So, you know, environmental activists concerned about what's going to happen to the land or maybe to the noise, you know, they will align with people living by the airport who might be very middle-class people simply don't want to have more noise and more pollution by the airport. So there's an alliance between those two groups, maybe an unusual alliance, you could think about it, but potentially a very effective one. And, you know, there have been airport campaigns where that alliance has actually been an effective one in the UK. There are papers written about that, and I don't know if Yara is watching, but one of them was called The Alliance of the Vegans and the Volvos, which I thought was quite funny. And this kind of alliance is elaborated and promoted in the kind of post-Marxist discourse of Laclau and Muth. So you can see that Laclau and Muth are trying to hang on to the idea of the possibility of emancipation. You know, the concept seems to be changed. For some people who are more influenced and shaped by very strong Marxist perspectives, this will seem like a terrible watering down of the idea of emancipation. For other philosophers, influenced by the postmodern and post-structuralist discourse, it will seem like a kind of abandonment of the theoretical notions that is regressing back to a crude Marxist orientation. Galifrey and Haslam indicate, this is the next slide, I think. I've jumped over that slide very quickly. I didn't put it up when I was talking, I'm sorry. Oh, for some reason, this is in really bold type. Perhaps it's because it says Galifrey and Haslam. I'm always promoting Galifrey and Haslam. You've noticed that, yeah? Apart from talking about Bentham, I talk about Galifrey and Haslam as well. So they indicate our notions of accounting, transparency, publicity are actually reinvigorated in the context of Laclau and Muth's work, arriving at a new pragmatist notion of emancipatory accounting, because one of the things that we can try to mobilize in relation to trying to achieve some kind of progress is accounting and to see its emancipatory dimension. It's almost as though we're bringing Bentham back and putting him in a more radical position today, you know, like his moment has arrived. Bentham thought, of course, that his moment would arrive much earlier. You probably know that if you visit the University College of London you can go to the Bentham Museum and you can see Jeremy Bentham. He died in 1832, but you can actually see Jeremy Bentham. His body was preserved. So, you know, it's not a pleasant topic. He got the idea, interestingly enough, from the Maori of New Zealand, you know, because Britain at that stage had an empire that included so many countries, including New Zealand, and Maori used to preserve heads. So he got the idea from Maori. He thought that he would be an example to the world. You know, he saw himself as a citizen of the world. He actually worked with people like Simon Bolivar to develop constitutions of countries such as Colombia. And you know, so he's important in the history of South America in that respect, and also Greece. As I was saying to Fernanda earlier, he did seem to have his fingers all over things, you know. And his work on constitution included work on accounting as something that... Oh, Yara is following the session, yeah. So she'll still be laughing about the vegans and the Volvos.
She mentioned she needs to read this one that you suggested.
Yes, the vegans and the Volvo, yeah, that's right. She won't be buying a Volvo anytime soon after my little speech, but it could be one of the more environmentally friendly cars, you know. Don't know. Yeah, so at the same time, of course, Galifrey and Aslam and other writers have a very strong appreciation of the kind of negative dimension of transparency. You know, the notion that there is transparency and transparency, the notion that transparency can also engender secrecy, even the notion that secrecy and transparency are part of the package, part of the balance that is needed. The notion that transparency can actually function so as to displace other forms of positive emancipatory control. You know, all these ideas, all these complexities about transparency are also appreciated in the Galifrey and Haslam perspective. Nothing very straightforward about these perspectives. But they are trying to bring back the idea that transparency can have a place. And again, they're not, despite what I just said about bringing Bentham back, they are not claiming in any sense to be Benthamite or anything, something similar to that. When we published Galifrey and Haslam 2003, Accounting and Emancipation, the book, Tony Tinker was one of the people who criticized the book, and he responded to the criticism, and he didn't seem to write to us anymore. We don't know why. We don't know why, but we did respond to his criticism. You can find these papers in Advances in Public Interest Accounting. Okay. Some of the interesting dimensions of the theory that Galifrey and Haslam constructed around emancipatory accounting. The latest paper on this kind of construction is probably the 2019 paper in Critical Perspectives on Accounting, which is about the history of the emancipatory accounting construct and goes back in particular to Tinker and looks at the developments more recently. One aspect is the idea that we can think about emancipatory accounting at the micro level. So, for example, we can do observation and intervention at the level, say, of a microorganization, and look at the way accounting's functioning can be changed so as to have a more emancipatory impact on that microorganization. Functioning. Now, of course, someone might say, why is that going to have any positive change in society? I think we underestimate the link between the micro level and the macro level. I think we underestimate it. If you think about organization, some people spend a great proportion of their lives working in organizations. So think about this for a moment. You know, who's the most important stakeholder of a business organization? It's very often the people who are working in it for most of their time. You know, whether they be the employees or indeed the managers who are working there, and indeed the accountants, you know, who are working there in the organization and devoting a lot of their time to this. And these people, depending upon the interactions that they have within the microorganization, will take various things from that experience. So they will impact upon the families or the places where they live, and the communities they go back to. They will be influenced by this. So what happens in the microorganizational context can actually influence a great deal more than the micro-organizational. And then you sometimes will get other organizations saying, oh, look what's happening here. Maybe we need to do this, you know. So there's all this kind of relationship between the micro level and the macro level. Sometimes very subtle things can make a difference. And there's that principle of equifinality. I don't know if you've heard of that principle of equifinality. It's a systems idea. I remember some paper was being given on management control, and I was in the audience, and I asked a question, and the presenter wanted to sort of distance himself from my perspective. So he said, I'm not critical. I don't follow your kind of thinking. And I said, well, okay, suppose there were two ways of achieving the same profit. And one of them involved all kinds of negative impacts upon the people working in the organization and on the environment. And another way involved much less negative impacts on people and the environment. But they both achieve the same profit. What would you follow? And he said, oh, yeah, I would go for the one that had the less impact on the people, you know, and the environment. And I said, okay, that's interesting. So your criteria actually is much more complicated than you were suggesting. You know, when you say the business should be driven entirely by profits and accounting should link to that, you know, your thinking is actually more complex than you realize. So this is the point. Secondly, plurality of accounting is aligned to different projects and interests. And these are ideas that you will also find in the writings of Judy Brown, for instance. Judy Brown is also someone very much influenced by Laclau and Mouffe, particularly Mouffe, actually, in terms of the linkage of accounting to democracy and notions of dialogics in accounting. The point is that you start to envisage not just the kind of accountings we've been talking about before, but many different accountings linked to the differing projects, identities, and interests that can bring about change. I guess we need to refer as well to the nature of these projects, identities, and interests, because we're not talking about any project or any identity or any interest. We're talking about projects, identity, and interests that can be seen through a critical lens as progressive. That is the point, that they are progressive. This is the point that Mouffe also makes clear in her work. But I guess intersubjective appreciation of that. There's no objective way of thinking about these things. At any moment in time, according to Galloway and Haslam, accounting reflects a mix of emancipatory and regressive forces. So this is a change in the way emancipatory accounting is often thought about. So we look at accounting in practice. It can be any accounting, and that's the point made right at the end there. It could be any accounting. Remember my story about the conventional accounting in the early 19th century. It could, I mean, you know, conventional accounts have been used in campaigns by labor activists. You can see this in the book by Gallup and Haslam in 2003. They use conventional accounts to drive their campaigns, sometimes with consequences that go beyond economic redistribution. You know, they may involve economic redistribution, but they also may involve better rights for the workers, achieving better rights and conditions, and other things as well. And conventional accounts being used in that context. I mentioned to Fernanda the other day that sometimes in labor disputes, the labor movements and the trade unions, they don't actually trust the accounting. They don't trust the accounting. They think it's going to act against them, and they don't trust it. But in different times in history and in different countries, good example is Germany, where trade unions are actually seriously studying accounting, you know, in their particular context. But at different times in history, accounting has been used as a kind of force and as a kind of servant of the labor interests. As Tinker might have said, and I think he did say something like this, accounting has no necessary class belongingness. That's what Tinker wrote in his kind of neo-Marxist face. Accounting, secondly, can become more or less emancipatory over time. Accounting can become more or less emancipatory over time. Some insights into how this happens are provided in Galofer and Haslam 1991. Now, Galofer and Haslam 1991 develop a kind of social theory in which, if I write on here, will it come through? I'll also talk about it. Many critical writers stress the content of accounting in the theorizing. But in the Gallagher and Haslam paper in 1991, we introduce these four dimensions or elements of accounting. And there are more. We can talk about the networks that accounting operates in, for instance. But in the 1991 paper, we see the source of the dynamic that ultimately kind of changes accounting to be around these four terms: content, but also form, usage, and aura. So not only what is in the accounts and what is not in the accounts, the question of content, because both are important, what is in the accounts and what is not in the accounts. And one of the things that the conventional accounting policymakers rarely talk about is the role of aggregation in hiding things in the accounts. Instead of, for instance, seeing how much everyone is paid by the organization, they will aggregate that to wages. You know, if anyone tells you that accounting is not political, talk about that issue. You know, whether you take the view that this should be disaggregated or not, take that issue and put that back. You know, well, what if the wages were all disclosed? Oh, we can't, you know. you know, the same with the, like the payments of taxes and the payments of all the different things that are paid to the governments. You know, aggregated to one figure, taxation, or aggregated to one figure, payments to government or whatever, you know. The sales in the different countries, aggregated to one figure sale, you know, this kind of thing.
Jim, this four dimensions, content, form, usage, and aura, you discuss
discuss these four dimensions in this 1991 paper with Sonia?
Yes.
Okay, good, good.
In accounting organizations and society. It's called the aura of accounting in the context of a crisis. Germany and the First World War.
And the aura is that idea that you were explaining, the role of aggregation of information that hides things.
That's in relation to content.
To content, okay.
Because, you know, content, you have the issue of what is actually made visible by the accounting and what is not. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And the process of things not being made visible is sometimes not so easy to realize, because it's something like aggregation of figures, you know, that's probably articulated in relation to a standard and expertise. You think of a consolidation. Think of consolidation. Consolidated accounts, which is a particular form of group accounting, became very prevalent in the English-speaking world in the 1930s. When there was a great deal of concern about the representation of companies that had subsidiaries all over the world and had all kinds of investments, and basically the kind of accounts that they were producing were really misleading. So they decided to try to represent them through a principle of consolidation. But you know, consolidation involves a lot of aggregation. It involves a lot of hiding of things as well. You know, you might say, oh, it's too confusing to show all the different accounts of all the different investments and all the different accounts of all the subsidiaries. Well, you know, these days you could try to do that because we have the internet and we have hyperlinks, and so you could put a lot more information out there compared with the 1930s. But yeah, consolidation itself, in some sense, may improve the representation of the economic entity, the large economic entity with lots of investments. But it also hides. It also aggregates. It also hides. And you know, not many people talk about that when they're teaching, for example, consolidated accounting. You know, consolidated accounting is very easily dominated by the technical, right? But there is a kind of visibility being created and another one being displaced through the aggregation. What do we mean by form? Well, it could be, for instance, that the accounts are in a form where you have to look to register to access the accounts. Or the form of accounts, it might be that they are published in a newspaper that many people can read. You know, at the time that we were looking at, Germany in the pre-First World War and First World War period, accounts were published in the newspapers in the business sections typically, and they were usually just a few lines: assets, liabilities, profits, this kind of thing. Assets, liabilities, capital, revenues, expenses. And it was just a few lines. You would then have the situation of today, where you could talk about the form in terms of, is it on the internet? Is it in published papers? What do the accounts look like? Are they very numerical? Are they more narrative? How are the numbers portrayed? Does it look like a sort of ordered set of numbers, or is it a bit more chaotic? You know, there are people who have written about the form of the accounts, almost like aesthetics, in terms of aesthetics. And they have suggested that the form of, for example, double entry bookkeeping was partly a kind of rhetoric to indicate that the business was being governed in accordance with a principle of order. And that this was indeed consistent with God's will. There are people who've written about that. So that the accounts of the early monasteries put into double entry bookkeeping in order to illustrate that they were legitimate business in God's eyes. Look at the order. look at the order in the books. So, you know, I'm just kind of going off on a bit of a tangent, but to illustrate the point of the importance of form and the many different meanings of form that we can think of. Maybe related to form, you could start to talk about notions of expertise. Are they seen as expert things? You know, that kind of idea. But these different elements kind of intersect and overlap. Usage is interesting because what we are saying is, who actually uses the accounts in practice? Who uses them? Because the great Nobel Prize winning economist Joseph Stiglitz, one of the few economists to write about accounting, and indeed to write about information in a very serious way. Joseph Stiglitz makes the point that once accounting is out there, once kind of disclosure is out there, we can't really control how it's used. So it might be the case that in principle, the people who are legislating for accounting, they're wanting, say, investors to use it, or they're wanting shareholders to use it, and they're wanting them to use it for a particular purpose. But in practice, they can use it in all kinds of different ways, and different people can use it. So I made the point earlier about, for example, Labour representatives can use the accounting in their campaigns. And the question of who uses it and how are interesting questions, because, you know, these things can change. This is the important thing to remember. The content, the form, the usage, who uses it and how. These things can change. And the aura, Fernanda, the aura is basically how the accounting is seen in society. What is its status? And again, you can talk about notions of expertise there. You can talk about notions of objectivity there. Is it seen as objective? Is it seen as a noble act? You know, a noble phenomenon, a worthy practice, something linked to the law when the law itself is seen as positive. Now, in Germany, for example, in the years before the First World War, accounting, the law, economic policy, they're all seen as things working together to drive the German economy forward, to bring Germany up, because it was only unified Germany in about 1870, to bring Germany up to the level, industrial level of, for example, the United Kingdom. You know, and accounting was seen as a really positive force in this context, as something driving that forward. Some of the most interesting writings on accounting were around the early 20th century in Germany. It was seen as driving things forward. They had a very strong economic perspective on accounting in those days. A famous writer called Schmalenbach, you may have heard of. There's a journal even today called the Schmalenbach Journal of Economics, and he was a big writer on accounting. By the way, Jeremy Bentham, sorry, again, you can see that I can't resist referring to Jeremy Bentham. But Jeremy Bentham and his brother Samuel, by the way, Samuel Bentham was the guy who thought about this idea of the panopticon, but didn't call it that, but he used it in his management practices, and Jeremy wrote about it in a theoretical sense and in a much broader sense. Jeremy Bentham and Samuel Bentham, the two brothers, they wrote a lot about accounting as something that could be improved, even though they didn't think the economic was so important. Certainly Bentham didn't think the economic was so important for accounting. He could see how accounting could be improved in an economic sense too, and give a much clearer representation of the economic values, as he saw it, of the business organization. So he was already into ideas of current value accounting and inflation accounting in the early 19th century. I thought I would mention that as well. You know, much of what we thought was new in the 20th century, social accounting, you know, all these ideas, can be traced to Bentham's writings, and of course he wasn't necessarily the first person either. Okay, we trace the changes in those things in Germany to indicate our counting can change in a different way. So this is kind of integrating a kind of social analysis of accounting with a notion of how accounting can change in a progressive way.
Going backwards to the previous slide, can we compare and contrast? Compare and contrast conventional accounting, environmental accounting, shadow accounting, counter accounting, silent accounting, in terms of content, form, usage, and aura.
Yes, we can. We can also talk about the different changes in those.
What kind of transformation they're seeking?
Types of accounting, yeah. Mm-hmm. We can see how those things change over time. We can try to analyze how they currently function in society. And just to go through those different things, conventional accounting will be the kind of accounting that the accountancy practitioners and the accountancy profession most business people, if you like, would see as accounting. They would see it as accounting. This is a kind of conventional accounting. The social and environmental accounting is the kind of accounting which is looking at the impact of the business organization on society and on the environment. Maybe it is also comparing the actions of the business with desirable social norms. So for instance, you could have accounting that looked at the constitution of the board of directors. Are they mainly men, or is there a significant proportion of women, or do they have a good representation of diversity on the board of directors? So this is kind of, you know, reflecting a social norm. And that could also be seen as a form of social accounting. Also, of course, greenhouse gas emissions, carbon accounting can also be seen as a very important branch today of environmental accounting. Shadow accounting, the notion of shadow accounting is where instead of the business agents like the managers, directors and so on, putting out the accounts, it is someone else who puts out the accounts. Instead of the government putting out the accounts, it is someone else putting out the accounts. So if you like, it's that idea of the unofficial accounting. But shadow accounting is a more general term than counter accounting, because counter accounting is deliberately trying to challenge the establishment, if you like, whether that be the business organization or the government. And in a sense, counter-accounting is nearer to Bentham's notion of unofficial accounting, unofficial publicity. Of course, in practice, people who write about shadow accounting, they usually mean counter-accounting. You know, they use the terms interchangeably, actually. If you look at Helen Tradidja's work, for example, she is using the word shadow accounting pretty much to mean counter-accounting, and many people do that. Silent accounting is hardly ever used these days. It's kind of passed into past its sell-by date, really, as a notion, as a construct. But it refers to the idea that in the main accounts you will find aspects of them that are really more social accounting and environmental accounting. You know, that they will be giving out information, giving out accountability on areas of the social and the environmental. And so they could be understood to be silent accounts. You know, they might not be labeled social and environmental accounting, but they are in effect social and environmental accounting, so the sand cuts. The other thing about social and environmental accounting, of course, is that for many, it includes the financial and economic accounting as well. So, you know, notions of moralistic accounting, including the social, environmental, and the economic. You've probably heard of the triple bottom line, and Global Reporting Initiative would embrace that concept of the triple bottom line. You've probably heard of integrated reporting, which tries to bring all those things together. Okay, but yeah, I mean, you can look at those things and the dynamics of them, and how they function in practice. You know, this is a sense in which, you know, there's still so much research on accounting to be done, and we were talking about journals yesterday and how they might not like particular topics. You know, they might not like, for example, publishing things where the accounting goes beyond the norm of accounting delineation, where the accounting is maybe mainly narrative, for instance. They might find that a problem to publish that. But really, it's very important as a writer that you don't feel restricted by that, and you try to fight, not literally, you know, trying to metaphorically fight in order to be heard and in order to be published in these areas. Okay, yeah, in terms of social theory generally, one of the principles of German critical theory, going back especially to the time of Adorno and Horkheimer and the early Frankfurt School, which Habermas has continued, if you like, various other writers more recently as well in that tradition. The thing that has always been a principle of theirs is this idea of openness to learn from others. The problem, of course, if you then start to write about others, like Habermas famously writes about Foucault and many other writers in his published work. The problem with that is that you're then seen as a kind of imperialist, because you kind of, you know, you're sort of consuming these other writers and positioning them in relation to your own perspective. But nevertheless, the principle that the critical theorists have of trying to achieve synthesis, a kind of synthesis between the different theoretical perspectives, is sadly a neglected area today, and it's contributed to a great deal, I think, of confusion between different theoretical positions, a sense of chaos in a way. I'm not saying that it's very easy to make synthesis between the different positions. I don't think it is. And incidentally, it's extremely difficult to publish papers where you're trying to synthesize different theoretical positions. That seems to be too complicated for journal editors and reviewers to handle. Not that I've tried to do it much myself, but you know, the point is that it is very difficult. I know it's very difficult. And yet, it seems to me to be something very worth doing. So for example, in that Gallifrey and Haslam 2019 paper, we definitely refer to the importance of trying to appreciate the different social theories and how they might be brought more together, and how notions like emancipatory accounting might somehow unite them. Whether the emancipatory accounting is explicit or whether it's more of a silent idea, you know, in other words, different theoretical positions are not necessarily wanting to attach to notions of emancipatory accounting, but in effect, they are seeking to achieve some betterment in the world, and that begins to unite them, at least at that level. The other thing, of course, is that critical edge, that critical orientation. That's the other sad thing about many perspectives today. They appear because the critical dimension is often so embedded, really, and so it's just not explicit. And there's a kind of sense of, oh, if we actually articulate this theory as a theory that's trying to change the world and make it a better place, it's not really academic, that's more politics, you know. It's not about really developing our understanding. And of course, Marx famously said, didn't he, as I'm sure people remember, past philosophers have sought to understand the world. The task, however, is to change it. Bentham also said something very similar. To paraphrase him, he said, I do not want to practice the law, I want to change it. Something very similar. But from a certain academic perspective, those ideas are seen as not really science. Not really science, because you're trying to change the world. But, you know, why do we have this science? You know, what is the underlying motivation of it? There's a beautiful text, which I would recommend to you if you've got any kind of doubts about this, by Richard Bernstein. I mentioned it yesterday, The Restructuring of Social and Political Theory. And there's this very critical appreciation of phenomenology in that text. Phenomenology is associated with the kind of interpretivist perspective that is not explicitly critical. And Bernstein is making the point that in the end, they have to be critical. You know, it's a great text to read if you feel that being critical in that sense is somehow not academic or not scientific. I still have this issue with a lot of collaborators who will say to me, oh, but you're biased, aren't you? And I said, yeah, but are you saying it's possible to do research without being biased? You know, this is my problem. I mean, what you can try to do is to be extremely open. So you have a position, you have an argument, you've got this position you're trying to do, but you're open to seeing things differently. You're really open, you really fight to be open. You know, to understand the world in some sense that you didn't really expect. That you can try to do, but I don't see how you can avoid bias. You know, because if you're not biased towards a critical position and wanting to achieve a better world, what is your position? You know, that's my problem, if you like, or whether it's a problem, I don't know. A lot of people are critical of the emancipatory accounting ideas, and they draw from different positions. Tweedy is one writer who certainly is critical of counter-accounting, seems to understand the counter-accounting as emancipatory accounting, which isn't actually the position, as I hope I've demonstrated that today. Seems to cast doubt on that, but I don't want to comment further. On that without more seriously considering that position. If you're going to develop a critique of, say, Gallifrey and Haslam 2019, personally, I think the critique you could make would be to talk about how slippery the ideas are. I can see that being a critique, but I find it difficult to critique it in other ways. You know, it's actually designed to be difficult to critique. That paper. The position in that paper is designed to be very difficult to critique. But then, you know, if you do develop a critique of it, the critique that's most likely to be substantial is one that points to its slipperiness. You know, you think you've got it, you think you've criticized it, but actually you've not. It's slipped away. And the coming back to Jeremy Bentham, there is a paper. Written on Jeremy Bentham, the title of which is Slippery Bentham. So I just make that point as a kind of analogy. Right, now two empirical studies that have used emancipatory accounting in different ways are Mascafar, Galofer and Haslam, 2016 Critical Perspective on Accounting. I think it's 2016, it might actually have been published in 2017. These days, things are often published online before they're published in the journal, and it causes quite a bit of confusion. So it might be 2017. And Chelsea's Gary et al., which was published in, I think, 2019. The thing about the Chelsea's Gary et al., that's about kind of external publicity, more macro level dimension. And the Mascafà et al. Is about the micro level. It's about the micro organizational level. It's actually about a Spanish software company that has a branch in France. And it's about the French branch of the software company. And it's talking about how changes in the interaction of the accountants with the others in the organization and changes in the interaction of the accounting over a significant period of time, I think about 3-year period of time, changed the lives of the people involved and actually improved their lives and gave a much greater sense of well-being to all the various parties that interacted. And accounting change seems to have been part of that, part of the reason for that change. So that's a micro-level study, trying to get over this idea of emancipatory accounting in the micro-level. The Chelsea's Gary et al. It starts to look at transparency and all the kind of progressive dimensions of transparency, but also the downsides of it as well. And it does that in relation to the EU directives, an EU directive on accounting. Okay, well, at that point, before I collapse, trying to drink water all the time, before I do that, I would like to invite further questions from the audience on any aspect of this, and I'll try to answer them now or possibly come back to you. If you ask me a difficult enough question, I'll probably say I'll come back to you. Which is not to disrespect questions that I think are canon.
Alguém tem uma pergunta aqui na sala? Ok, vamos lá. Pessoal do YouTube também pode fazer pergunta agora também, colocando no chat, tá?
So, Jen, what do you think about emancipatory account? That's some approximately and something related with the colonial theory?
Yes, I mean, again, the richness, possible richness, potential richness of emancipatory accounting is enormous, and we're learning all the time about how notions of emancipatory accounting can be constructed and what kind of consequences they have, and also looking at this in terms of social theory, thinking about post-colonial critique and about decolonial theorizing in order to develop the notions of emancipatory accounting, both in terms of critique of existing practices, but also promotion of new practices, you know, and how accounting can also have this dimension of producing betterment in this kind of sphere, you know, where the concerns are about, for example, decolonialism. Because, you know, in terms of the Laclau and Mu theory, that will be one of the many identities and projects and, you know, moments that we try to understand and transform the dimension. And of course, here in Brazil, we've been doing work on that. You've been doing work on that as well, and you know, that's really exciting work for the future. We have a paper at the moment in progress. The three of us, Tarek, Fernanda, and myself, and you know, we're trying to make that really work because it would be a big contribution to that particular area. It really would be a big contribution. To that, right? Okay.
I have a question. At the beginning of a presentation, you were articulating Hegelian view of current situation and the betterment. And then you mentioned the idea of vision, the vision that is necessary to social transformation. And I was kept thinking, we are having several recent contributions from historical studies. Some colleagues that are doing, that are accessing archives,
yes,
maybe to counter, to have counter narratives, yes, on historical forms of oppression and inequality, and how we can reconstruct and understand how these forms of oppression traces back to our past, our colonial past, in our case in Brazil. So I would like to hear from you, how do you see the contributions of historical studies to emancipatory accounting, to enabling accounting, and how should the authors pose and present and position that kind of contribution to the literature and to our future betterment?
Yeah, that's great. I've got this. Should be still working. I definitely, I'm very strong here that history is really important in the study of accounting, including from a critical perspective and from a social theoretical perspective. I feel that this is really important because on the one hand, you can build up a much greater understanding of the present. You can understand the present much, much more deeply if you appreciate the historical context. You know, like things that could have been different, things that could have gone in different ways, or just understanding, for example, that at one point in the historical context, what we now consider to be quite, I don't know, humdrum, conservative even, was a radical idea, you know, or how some practices in history have been quite provocative and had quite a disturbing impact upon the established order, and now very different. So understanding this is really important, and also looking back as well, you can see new things, because the things that you didn't appreciate, you don't appreciate, they're kind of buried in the layers of history, and by digging in and understanding these things, you appreciate things differently today. You see new possibilities for areas like accounting. I mean, one of the key things, again, that I would emphasize is just how important accounting is. I'm not sure if I see accounting quite as important as Bentham did. He was obsessed by accounting, I would say. Yeah, he was obsessed by accounting. But, the idea that it's important for our world today does actually resonate with me. Because you can't have a proper governance system without accounting. Not as I see it. You know, accounting and governance are like that. Accounting and management are like that. They go together like that. They are part of the package. And therefore, if you're interested in the notion of better governance, if you think that it matters that we govern ourselves in particular ways, you're interested in accounting. It's a big thing. It's important. The way that Bentham put it, and it is interesting to think back to the, I keep talking about Bentham, but you could talk about many Enlightenment writers of the period on administration, and you will find them in Portuguese, for example, as well as English, if you look back at that particular period historically. Fascinating period. You have what she called Catherine the Great. Catherine the Great, who was an Austrian, who was the Empress of Russia. Catherine the Great wrote a great deal on administration. Actually, there's a debate on how much she actually wrote and what she just put a name to, But, there are lots of texts in the 18th century written in French, for instance, that are on administration, that talk about accounting, that write about accounting. and can illuminate things for us today. So, you know, okay, I keep talking about Bentham a lot, but I don't want to give you the impression that it's only about Bentham. That historical period is really interesting in terms of people writing about accounting. There's a lot of interesting work by German writers. Immanuel Kant, you know, famous philosophers like Kant, famous literary scholars like Herder, you know, these people wrote about accounting. And we don't really fully appreciate these things today. We need to, in part, suspend our current way of thinking in order to try to understand them better, and then to rearticulate that for the present. But yeah, the way that Bentham put it, he said, you know, the most important principle of management, the most important principle of governance is this idea of the panopticon, you know, the all-seeing principle, whereby the behavior will be improved and people will feel better because the behavior is improved. You know, you can talk about the naivety of that. And of course, it's definitely an idea that has a dark side. It's definitely an idea that can be misapplied. Definitely is the case. That's definitely the case. But for him, it was like good intention, you know. And then the second principle that's important is accounting. That's the second principle, because it is the servant of the panopticon principle. That's the idea. It is the servant. And so that's the second dominant principle in his kind of way of seeing. And of course, Foucault famously, you know, in The Eye of Power and Discipline and Punish, sees this as a kind of metaphor of modern society. It's quite interesting, you know, if you look at Foucault, there's an ambivalence in terms of the way he thinks about Bentham. An ambivalence that you find, of course, throughout postmodern, post-structuralist writers. You know, they're sometimes also very slippery in terms of what they really are trying to get at. But you know, this panopticon idea is seen as a kind of metaphor of modern society, and allows you to bring out many dark sides of this modern society. You know, we think it's progress, but actually, it's not you know, this kind of idea. We think it's an improvement, but actually not so sure, you know. Okay, yeah.
We have two more questions. Yep. I'll get close to you so your microphone can capture my voice. Mariana Guerra is asking if, in your opinion, is there some type of organization where accounting publicity, you're talking about Bentham, official publicity, unofficial publicity.
Yeah.
Is there any type of organization in which accounting publicity is not important? She was thinking about small non-profit Brazilian organizations, for instance. And we have several other questions from Alain. I'll leave you, Mariana, get her question.
It's a good question, Mariana, about the smaller company, you know. But I would make an observation about that. And it's an observation I've made before in relation to accounting jurisdictions, where requirements on the smaller business are relatively less than the larger businesses. But the point I would make is that you've still got the situation where many people will spend their lives working in these smaller organizations. If you look at economies generally, you tend to find that there's an awful lot of people employed by smaller businesses. You know, if you look at the position from a more aggregate level, and they will spend their lives working in these organizations, many of these people. So if you believe that their lives matter, then you are concerned about the issue of governance, and therefore you're concerned about the issue of accounting, which would include notions of accounting publicity. So yes, is my answer. You know, it definitely matters. It definitely matters. Now, whether you've got a situation where in practice it's not mattering, yeah, of course that's a possibility, but that wouldn't indicate that it didn't matter.
Yeah. I see. Good. The this connect to several projects we are trying to develop.
Yeah.
What
yeah.
Society seems as unimportant and unnecessary to have an accounting or alternative accounts of some issues. Yeah, really good. Alain, as you know, Alain, he had several comments here in the chat, and he's saying, some critical accounting researchers have sought to understand accounting from what it is not yet, what it is to become. Do you think we can look at micro-social processes as alternatives to change the current accounting logic at the macro level, the micro to the macro? Can changes to accounting logic currently used emerge from practices at the micro level? Can we understand this as emancipatory accounting?
A couple
of points there. I mean, first of all, really interesting about what accounting is not, and so on. And Anthony, Anthony Otwood used to use an expression about accounting change, where he was talking about accounting becoming what it was not. You know, he had an interesting style, and that's how he talked about accounting change, accounting becoming what it was not. The point, I'm just trying to grasp the point that, could you possibly repeat the question, Fernanda?
Yes.
Because I did have an interesting answer, I think, to that question, and
can
it's gone.
Changes to accounting logic currently used emerge from practices at the micro level?
Yeah, the answer to that is yes. The answer to that is yes, because it's one dimension, if you like, of the pragmatic notion, the new pragmatist notion, because we need to operate both at the micro level and the macro level. You know, we can't do everything that is required at the macro level, because the issues are too big. The issues are too problematic. It's the detail that's important. Now, of course, some people would say, why are you trying to sort of control the detail? I agree about the danger of that. I agree about the dangers of that. But even though, the famous Marxist collaborator, Friedrich Engels said, this kind of worry that we have about too much power being exercised from the center, this kind of worry that we have is actually mankind's fear of itself, which is an interesting thing to say. I mean, it does make you think. I agree both that it is mankind's fear of itself, but that it is a legitimate fear. It is a legitimate fear because, there was the famous Lord Acton expression, power corrupts, absolute power corrupts absolutely. I certainly can relate to that notion, which if you explore, Zizek's work is very good on this. Zizek has a book, I think it's called, Did Somebody Say Totalitarianism? I think that's what the book is called. It's a picture of Lenin on the front of the book with a newspaper. You just see Lenin's eyes. I don't know if you've seen it. And the title of the book is Did Somebody Say Totalitarianism? So it's actually Lenin. You're imagining Lenin saying this while he's reading his newspaper. And it's about like different misinterpretations of totalitarianism over time. But I definitely appreciate the sense in which if you haven't got that kind of possibility of changing the society, if you haven't got the possibility of throwing out the leaders, you've got a problem. I can see that. But at the same time, I think Engels' point about mankind's fear of itself also has a resonance. To me, it's particularly important these days in relation to the environment. I can see the point, many people would agree with me on this, I think, that if we somehow are not able to deliver this collectively as a humankind, if you like, then it's going to be a disaster. You know, and so we somehow from somewhere have to get the ability to coordinate beyond all these things, beyond the historic history, beyond the politics. We somehow have to do it. It's the major challenge we have. And I would say it's not just the environment. I remember Stuart Hall, the political theorist, saying that this was the final global problem. This was the final global problem. But actually, if you think about human rights, if you think about conditions of people, labor conditions, it's really important that we act together as a world. It really is. Somehow we have to do it. We can do it potentially without a global government. There are some people who argue for global government. We can do it without that, but it requires an awful lot of coordination, an awful lot of coordination between the different governments of the world. And you only need a few to break with that coordination and you've got problems. And of course, today we know that there's a very big country, China, there's a very big country, India. You know, these countries potentially can make or break the situation, you know. And this is why I think when you think about these countries, instead of always concentrating on the negative, which is what people tend to do, which I think is really dangerous, actually. Really dangerous to do that. We should be looking for any positives in order to build these possibilities. That's my view.
Yeah, and it goes back to the first part of your speech when you were saying that if revolution, complete revolution is impossible, our way out of a crisis is through micro practices,
indeed,
micro level, and the coordination of several
things are possible through the micro level, I think, and through individuals. And, you know, I mean, individuals themselves are going to change, and it's all like conscious and subconscious.
Yeah.
I can tell a joke, if you like, inspired by Zizek. Would you like to hear a joke inspired by Zizek about the importance of the subconscious? There's a man, he goes to the doctor, and he says, "Doctor, I have a problem. I think I am a crumb of bread. I think I am a crumb of bread." You understand, a crumb of bread, yes? And the doctor says, "Oh dear, this is a big problem. Let me spend some time with you." A few hours later, and obviously wasn't working for the National Health Service in Britain. few hours later, the man leaves the doctors and he's convinced that he is not a crumb of bread. Proudly walks out to the doctor, but then he runs straight back in, and straight back into the doctor's surgery. Oh no, no, no! At the door there is a chicken. There is a chicken. I think it's going to eat me. And the doctor says, "No, no, no! We've spent so long on this. You know you're not a crumb of bread." And he says, "But does the chicken know?" Okay, it's a nice joke. It's a nice joke.
Luciana has a question too. She's thinking about the dimensions of change, and she's asking, what suggestions can be raised when using emancipatory accounting at the micro level? I think in terms of research too. What kind of suggestions do you have?
Oh, yeah, it's a very good question. I think apart from, you know, having a sort of framing where you're trying to find and discover these things, because sometimes from a critical perspective, it's quite difficult to uncover what might be positive leads here, what might be progressive dimensions of practices that appear to be very mundane practices, very governed by more capitalistic type principles. And you're trying to uncover something different about them. So I think having that framing is important, but it's also just important to be very open, to try to observe, to look at the detail, and almost indeed, you know, the value of something like grounded theory for that, you know, the value of something where you're actually suspending so many views as possible to try to understand the practice. To deliberately be as open as you can. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, great. Yara is laughing about the crumb and the chicken.
Yes, I thought she would do. I thought she would do. Yes.
Okay, any more questions in the room? We have, we don't have questions on YouTube. I think we must thank Professor Jim Haslam for this amazing presentation on Nervous Patriot County. It was a complete lecture. You came from all the conceptual details, theoretical, and the evolution of the concept in the literature. It was amazing. Thank you.
There's people out there saying, ah. Okay.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you so much, Jim. Yeah,
thank you.
We'll have another lecture in the afternoon. It will start 2:30. Duas e trinta da tarde, nós vamos ter uma segunda palestra. São todos convidados. Muito obrigada. Muito obrigada.
Obrigada. Obrigada. Thank you. Thank you.